Hello everybody. Today I'm going to share some of my thoughts on what freedom really means. Okay. I'm not going to present a framework of how to build a free society. That is not really the scope of this talk, but just a collection of different thoughts which I wanted to share. Okay, so on the left you see an icon of Subramanya Bharati. He is a great Tamil poet, and he wrote some amazing songs and prose that contributed greatly to the Indian freedom movement. So when you talk about freedom, many of us do not really give much thought to it. But once you build an understanding of your grand vision of your free world, how your free world will look like, how you can live with great freedom in that world, then it becomes really difficult to go back and get into the today's context, in today's world, because the world we are living in today is not exactly a free world, for whatever reason. I mean, there are many reasons to it. Some of the reasons we will explore today. Okay. But it is like letting air out of your balloon by bursting the balloon. Once the balloon is burst, once the air comes out, it is impossible to put it back. So this is also a fair warning to the you people who utterly believe in the current system of governance, in the current system of medical care and education and so on and so forth. So if you think there is absolutely nothing wrong or there is nothing that needs to be explored on any of these, you are going to find this discussion rather difficult to follow. Okay, so when you talk about freedom, the first thing comes to my mind is free flying, right? You jump in the air and just fly free. So here I am flying in Kerim Beach, Goa, a few years back. So if you have the resources, you should really learn paragliding because the sense of free flight, it has to be experienced. It's unbelievably amazing. And here is what Leonardo da Vinci said: once you have tasted flight, you will forever walk the earth with your eyes turned skyward, for there you have been and there you will always long to return. Flying always gives you a sense of great freedom. So I just wanted to say that upfront, so to just free up your mind. So when you talk about true freedom in a human society, true equanimity or equity in every sense of the word is the foundation of that true freedom. Without this equity in every sense, one group of people always will gain control over others or other group of people. Okay, let's say if there are two parties existing, then both parties should have equal power in every sense of that word, in terms of control over resources, in terms of offensive and defensive capabilities, in terms of knowledge, in terms of everything. Otherwise, one group is going to dominate, and sooner or later, it is going to overrun people on the in the other group. Okay, it really doesn't matter what you call this group, these groups as. Okay, so the label really doesn't matter. For example, one group you can call as government. Okay, so then another group you can call as people or the governed, who are not part of this government. So if this group called government has all the weapons and complete control over natural resources, and the other group doesn't have any of this, then that is not a true equity. true freedom cannot exist in this kind of a situation. Okay, no, I am not saying all the governments in the world are bad, but the very model of our present existence, how the society is organized, it is not organized in a way that encourages true freedom. Okay, the one group of people have enormous amount of power, enormous amount of control over other group of people. That is the current situation. So if such a disparity exists between the two groups, so what is going to happen? So if the first group disagrees with the second group for something, what exactly are they going to do? So if the first group again decides to exercise their power in whatever sense to oppress or take control of the second group, then what is the second group going to do? Absolutely nothing. Okay, so to whom will the second group go and complain? Because there are only two groups. If the other group is much more powerful, then where is the second group going to complain to? Right? Nobody, basically. Basically nobody. So to illustrate the point, let's say there is an isolated remote village in maybe Himalayas, Indian mountains, right? Nobody travels out of the village and nobody comes in. They grow their own food and they live as a small community among themselves. But that village is part of the Indian India, the country of India, right? And then one fine day, the Indian government decides to mandate a vaccine because there has been an outbreak of a virus in the whatever a disease in the country. And then they say, okay, now we are every person should be saved from this great menace. Okay, so the great epidemic where people are dying. So every person must be given an injection to safeguard that person. So all of a sudden, there is a group of healthcare workers and a few people from the army who enable these workers to do their duty in safeguarding the people against this menace. They arrive in this particular village. Okay. Now, what happens to the freedom of that village? Practically nothing. They'll do the incoming group will do as they please because they have all the power, and they imagine that they also have the authority to impose their will onto the village people. Okay, this is not equanimous. Okay, so between these two groups of people. So that is where the freedom is absent. Now, let's also look at this US Constitution. This one says the Congress shall have power to lay and collect taxes, duties, impose and excise, and provide for the common defense and blah, blah, blah. Now, it says the Congress. So this Congress, what is this Congress, right? And it says it shall have power. They did not talk about the responsibility. Okay, it did not say the Congress shall have the responsibility. It didn't say that. It says the Congress shall have power. It's an absolute statement. It's a statement to the people, telling people that, well, we are going to have power. Who are we? We are called the Congress. Okay. So, just a bunch of people, they got together in whatever context, right? They form a very small fraction of the population, and they said they belonged to something called a Congress. And then they wrote on a piece of paper that this particular Congress shall have power to collect taxes from everybody, practically, right? So the Congress is not even a physical person. It is not even a specific organization of specific people. It is simply a virtual entity to which everybody has to actually pay real resources, the real efforts and real assets. And this Congress can exist forever because it is a virtual entity, and the set of people inside the Congress can be substituted with another set of people, maybe their kids or maybe another bunch of their relatives or whoever they so choose. So it's a very clever way of taking away people's freedom, people's resources, and to let a bunch of people enjoy it. Okay, so I'm sure you are going to have a lot of arguments to tell me that this is not a true representation of how the Constitution really works. I would suggest you need to maybe review that in what I have said so far, because people are well trained to look at the current system of governance and the current system of how things are run in the world as a benign way of doing things, and people are actually convinced that they are living in a free world. But if you really dig into the details and see what exactly is happening, this is what you are going to see. It's just a set of people. They are no more powerful than you and me. Okay, they did not have more sovereignty or what do you say, more authority than either you or me. Now, the Indian Constitution got much smarter. Okay, so if you look at the US Constitution, they were very blatantly saying that, okay, the Congress has the power to collect taxes from everybody. But as time progressed, when Indian Constitution got written, they got much smarter. Okay, so instead of blatantly telling people, I'm coming for your resources, they simply say, no tax shall be levied or collected except by the authority of law. Therefore, each tax levied or collected has to be backed by an accompanying law passed either by the parliament or the state legislature. Okay, so, but essentially, it again boils down to a few people calling the shots over a very large number of people in the so-called country. Okay, it's not any different from the United States Constitution, or it is not any different from any of the free and democratic countries across the world, which are supposed to be living in freedom. Now, freedom to travel, this is a very fundamental nature of human beings, to travel from one place to the other, because we are very curious creatures. We want to know, okay, I am here, what is there in my next place, right? So what is after the ocean? I see a lot of water here. I want to know what happens, what is the land? If there is a land after this ocean, I want to know. So traveling from one place to the other is the basic nature of human beings. In a free world, any human being should be free to travel anywhere. This is an absolute statement, right? It doesn't matter what the world looks like or how dangerous it is or who has what rights. It should not really matter. A human being, if it is a free world, just like all human beings, any human being should be able to freely travel anywhere he or she wants to. However, that person should be personally responsible for taking care that he doesn't harm other people or damage their property. It's as simple as that. It is absolute common sense. Okay, if everybody is told this, that, hey, you can go anywhere, you can do whatever you want, I mean, you can travel anywhere and see, but just take care that you don't mess with people and you don't damage any property. Otherwise, you can travel. If this is told to people, everybody have the intelligence to understand this and actually do it also. If I told you to do this, Do you really think you are not capable of doing this, taking care that you don't harm people and don't damage property? Of course you can. So can I, and so can everybody else. A great illusion is to think that not everybody is going to understand this or follow this. That is a great illusion that you have been told, you have been taught to believe, but that is not the case. Human beings are much more intelligent than what the media and the entire propaganda machinery has been continuously telling people. Okay, so our brain is always being kept busy in entertainment and very, very low grade, activities that actually decrease our intelligence, decrease our inborn ability to understand and appreciate complex things. So even if he does harm inadvertently, or suppose he gets angry with somebody and then he goes and fights with them, he bears the responsibility for that. Okay, so for example, today you own a car, let's say. You drive the car wherever you want to drive. In a free world, you can take your car and drive across everywhere. Everywhere meaning literally everywhere. From India to China and China to Europe, Europe to wherever you want to go. So you should be able to just go. So on the way, if you have hurt somebody, then you are personally responsible and liable for the damages that you cause. Okay, but today we are hiding behind this thing called insurance. So people somehow think that if they have taken insurance, then they can do whatever they want on the road, and something untoward happens, then the insurance company will take care. Yeah, it takes care, but at what cost? At a great cost of taking away your freedom. Okay, so at the great cost of putting you in dependence of another system which dictates how and where you can travel and what is allowed and what is not allowed. That in my point of view is a great loss. It's incredibly great loss for nothing. I mean, in return, that the insurance thing what we get is absolutely nothing. So if you bear the responsibility for your own behavior and agree to be honest, agree to be careful in a very commonsensical way, then there are no other rules necessary for you to travel wherever you want to travel, because the entire world is full of people, full of human beings. So there are really no other rules necessary. Any rule which is beyond this, it is going to take away your and my freedom. Okay, and if so, it also implies that nobody will have any freedom, right? So when I don't have the freedom to travel, I'm going to pull down everybody else also. So it is either we understand this and free ourselves up from the current system, break it completely, and say screw this, and then we become free in the entire world, or we have to be part of this entire system and continue, and we have to find our way back to this true freedom to travel anywhere and everywhere we want to, that which is our I would say it's our birthright and our sovereign right to travel. Okay, what do you really mean by a country, right? So what is the purpose of defining a country? If you really look at it, one group of people, imagine that other group of people are going to harm them. So to protect themselves from the other groups, they define something called a country. Okay, they define a physical boundary, they define some economic boundaries. They define a lot of things, languages, so-called culture, and so on and so forth. A whole lot of things they define around themselves. And then they start living inside that particular cocoon, like a shell. right? They are inside, and they consider anybody outside as the other people. But the funny part is, it is a, the other people also have the same objective. They don't want to be taken for a ride by anybody else in the world. Okay, so they also want to live happily and without restriction. They also want to enjoy the freedom this world offers, right? Then why is this boundary even needed? Why do we even need a country? So once you define a country, you put yourself in a very narrow understanding of yourself and this entire world. Not only that, it leads to fear. It is easy to scare people living in a country, a bounded place, your mental and physical boundary. So once they are inside that boundary, it's very easy for a bunch of people to come and scare the hell out of that population by continuously telling that all other groups are conspiring to rule over you. But those are the real people who are ruling over this entire population itself. So the very concept of country is needed only when a small set of people want to rule over a large population. If this is not there, if this desire is not there, and everybody wants to be free, the very concept of country itself is not really necessary. Okay, so the key mechanism by how this small group of people can achieve this is by creating a lot of confusion, a lot of discord, and offering to mediate to resolve the problems. Those problems are first of all created by the confusions and discord and all those things. And then they also offer the solution to mediate and bring everything to normal. And then we create something called an army, right? You have Navy, you have Air Force, and you have military. You create all kind of weapons. For what purpose? To protect you from other people who also want to be protected against you. So this is fundamentally flawed, the very concept of countries. Itself is absolutely fundamentally flawed. If we remove that and we understand that all human beings have equal rights, not rights, I mean the meaning of the word rights is a nonsensical term in a free world. Okay, so when a group of people say I have this right and I have that right, it really means they are fighting over some kind of a resource. They want to own the resource, or they want to consume that particular resource over taking higher priority over some bunch of other groups of people. So that is what it really means. Okay. So if in a world which is abundant in resources, this is absolutely unnecessary. Okay. So if this is well understood, the world will simply consist of a small, prosperous and self-sustaining and highly networked communities. That is how the world actually should be. So here is an example of how, what do you say, an entire race of people got destroyed by, again, a small group of people. Okay, so this is what you see is a mountain of bison bones. Okay, so this is in 1860s. So the incoming Europeans were building railroads all across America, and then the Native Americans were being driven into very small territories. So they realized that the bison is the key food for the Native Americans. So the incoming settlers, they made it a point that they just kill all the bison across the land. So probably more than a million bison, I think, would have been killed. And then that really wiped out the resistance from the Native Americans. And then the Native Americans finally had no way to maintain themselves as a coherent group, and then they surrendered. So that is what happened. So this is how the modern world has created this kind of setup. Now it's entirely based on violence and not giving any thought to freedom and sovereignty of people and respecting that in any way. It is simply a dog eats a dog world, right? That is how this was built. Now everything comes to the resources, right? Why a group of people demand rights? They demand rights over some kind of resource. Otherwise, there is nothing to demand. If everybody has all kind of resources and they have access to all the required resources, then there is nothing for them to demand something over somebody else. So today's world is given to understand that the resources are very, very limited in our world, which is not really true. We have incredible amount of resources in every sense of that word resource, in terms of oil, in terms of food, in terms of clothing, shelter. You talk about any kind of resource, it is abundantly available, which can serve way more than what is there with the population, what population we have today in the world. Okay. So one of the greatest illusion is convincing ourselves that we have limited resources. So this is a great way to keep people under control, because once you tell somebody, yeah, I mean, we have only limited resources, so I am going to manage these resources and protect you from these resources running out. So please, you have to obey me. What I'm telling you, you have to follow, and so on and so forth. They can say that and people obey, right? But the very first step towards that kind of control is to convince people that we have limited resources. Once the people believe in that myth, then who manage such limited resources become the owners of the population. Literally, they become the owners of the population. So because population will listen to anything they say. You need to research Agenda 21. Okay, so this is a great place for you to look into what the UN is planning for the world. So, all the countries, including India, the governments and those people in power, to keep this kind of resource shortage illusion intact, they waste a lot of resources, sometimes directly, sometimes indirectly, sometimes in terms of the economic collapses. So they always keep a sense of shortness of resource for everything. Food, shelter, clothing, entertainment, anything you take, they always maintain certain level of shortness of shortage of resources. Okay, for example, in India, we waste over 40% of our grains, food production, by keeping it in the godown and by rotting them inside the godown. 40%. That is the entire production of Indian grains, right? Over a year, 40% is wasted. Only 60% is actually used and distributed. Even that gets wasted in so much along the supply chain. So that 40% amounts to 150% of India's annual budget for agriculture, which means that if we use the 40% properly, for agriculture will be free in the country. Everybody will get their food practically for free, right? That is true food sovereignty. But no, we are not going to achieve that, because the powers to be don't want that. So this 40% in turn wastes 25% of fresh water, okay? And 25% of population is starving right now. And 5% of people don't even have access to clean drinking water in India. This is a man-made situation. It has nothing to do with the real resource situation in India. And to illustrate further, we have about 10 million houses which are vacant in India. Okay, so in Mumbai alone, which is termed the most prosperous and very rich city, 0.5 million homes are kept intentionally vacant. And around that, around the same empty houses, over 11 million people are actually living in slums. That is the kind of, artificial resource crunch we have been creating in terms of food, in terms of shelter, in terms of everything practically. Okay, so this is an illusion. That is what I just wanted to tell you. Now, money, right? I just wanted to say a few things on money. So in today's world, it is a foregone understanding that money is a fundamental thing. If you take away money from the society, a society cannot exist. So that is the current understanding. This is not really true. Okay, so money is neither necessary nor important for human society to have a prosperous life on this amazing world. So let us see how the money came about. So there are different ways to explain this. I will just take a very simple case, which also ties into how few people get to control the world. Let us say you have a bag of rice. Okay, so I have a bag of potatoes. Now we want to share it. I want some of your rice, and you want some of my potatoes. And we want that to be on just and equitable basis, right? I want to ensure that I get my potatoes worth of rice from you. I don't want to pay more to you, right? Same way with you. Then we start arguing, right? Because it is never a simple thing. So we will go into how much effort I have spent, and you will talk about how difficult it was for you to process the paddy, and you will tell me how easily I just pull out the potato from the ground, and all that back and forth. We'll talk about it and we start arguing. And then suppose there is a third person who has nothing. He doesn't have anything. He is just watching us argue over this. And then he comes along and says, let me mediate between you two. Okay, and let me settle this argument. Because you don't seem to be settling this among yourselves. So you need a third party. So that is where the problem comes. Okay. He somehow convinces both of us that 1 kg of rice should be equivalent to 5 kg of potatoes. He puts forward certain logic, which looks great for both of us. Okay. Not that we could not have thought about it ourselves, but since a third party who is supposedly neutral to both parties come in and say that, we are more agreeable to it. Okay. Let's say you and I agree to this, and then we exchange our goods. Then when the next transaction is about to happen, we will naturally seek the help of this third person. Because even though we exchanged last time, this time again the situation may be different and we may not agree. So we seek this seek this third person. Now the third person knows that he has control over you. Okay, so you have real resources. This guy has no resources, but he knows that he has control over you. To deepen his control over you and the resources, he now defines something called a unit of value, right? He writes on a piece of paper 10 rupees or $10 and then gives you your $10, 10 notes, and gives the other guy, gives me $10. Just write it on a piece of paper and gives me. Okay, so he says, okay, now you two exchange this for goods and services, both of you. So one unit is 1 kg of potato equivalent, and so on. So you will define some standard for it. Okay. So now it becomes very convenient for you to do this. He also declares that from now on, he would be the authority to take care of such exchange of units of value. Okay, because we too do not know how to do that very well, even though we are the owners of the resources. So, without any resources, he has now become an indispensable part of the transaction. Okay, the transaction is only between you and me. He has inserted himself into it. He serves no purpose other than to pacify the two of us and make us agree to something, which we could have ourselves agreed to in the first place. Okay, so as such, this guy's help is entirely redundant if we two have agreed among ourselves. So once this is an example between just the two people. If you expand this into multiple people, the situation is becomes a little more complex. And if everybody has a big ego, then obviously the necessity of this third party becomes inevitable. And then once this money is widely accepted, right, and everybody starts exchanging money, then that is when the phenomena of wealth concentration starts to come into play. Okay, so any money-based system, wealth concentration is inevitable. So what do you mean by wealth concentration, right? Wealth concentration is that few people get more and more of the wealth in a pyramid-like structure. And the guy at the top practically will control a huge amount of wealth in that society. Why this wealth concentration happens is that everybody wants more money for themselves. Okay, so but and also everything gets simplified into a single thing. Okay, so instead of worrying about how the rice is made, how other vegetables are made, or how your guy runs your kitchen, what kind of resources he is employing, all I have to do is give him 10 rupees and he is going to give me a meals. He is going to satisfy my hunger for the evening. So you need not even think about how your community runs. Nothing. All you have to understand is that you this money, if I get more from my environment, that is all I need. I need not understand anybody. I don't care about other people, whoever they are, I don't care. So that kind of attitude builds up. So the human intelligence, which is capable of understanding very complex things, becomes much, much diminished. And the greed and fear, everything gets magnified by this instrument of money. But fundamentally, money is simply a token of value. Okay, so that gets buried. Money becomes something having some inherent value. The real value is in actual resources and actual people managing those resources, producing goods and services and all that. But from an individual point of view, all of that gets glossed over and gets replaced by just this token of value, which is money. So what happens is people tend to lose the higher perspective of living together in a community. When somebody else is unable to produce paddy for lack of some resource, I don't really care, because I can buy the same paddy from somebody else for some kind of money, for the same money that I can pay this guy. So the social perspective tends to become simpler and simpler, and individuals become less, intelligent, basically. So what happens is individualism, dependence on centralized services, such as especially the financial services, that becomes the norm of that particular society. So eventually such a system has to collapse, because the expectation is always greater than the value that actually exists in the society. Okay, so to give an example, if somebody is willing to sell me a bag of potatoes for 10 rupees, next time I want the same potato for 9 rupees. I want less price. Where is that? What am I going to do with this 1 rupee? I want to put it in the bank and I want to earn interest on that 1 rupee. Where is that interest going to come from? If it cannot come from thin air, right? If it comes from thin air, then it has no value. Somebody else has to produce something of value for that particular interest. Okay, but it is impossible to keep on producing higher and higher value in your society, because our efforts and intelligence have limits. So the more value we produce as a society, the more expectations individuals build up, always. So what happens as the expectations grow, then the value of money becomes lesser and lesser, inflation, right? That happens. Okay, so that this economical part we can go through later, but this is the very basis of the wealth concentration effect. If you are using money-based value exchange in your society, wealth concentration is practically impossible. I'm impossible to stop. Freedom to learn. Okay, so in today's world, once a child knows how to read and write a language and has a fair idea of family and her community, you should be introduced to the entire gamut of knowledge available to that child. Okay, so this is not happening today. So our education system today is geared towards producing obedient workers. It is not producing a fully intelligent, healthy human beings. We need to fix that at a very fundamental level. We need to fix the education system and the healthcare system to make sure that we produce human beings of great health, and change our education system such that such a healthy person also is free to learn and expand his understanding and contribution to the society. So how do we regain our sovereignty? The first part is to break through this fear-based control systems. You cannot break through that without gaining knowledge. Okay, so knowledge is the key. So knowledge of what is really happening. Okay, so knowledge of wealth concentration. In today's society, anything which is of value, for example, if you talk about wealth concentration and say that only very few people are actually controlling the world, then it is immediately labeled as a conspiracy theory by the mainstream media. And then it is the same mainstream media is telling everybody that this is a conspiracy theory. Okay, so but the real conspiracy, actual conspiracy, is the creation of this centrally controlled media itself. Okay, so you need to first reject this phrase wherever you see this is another conspiracy theory. Your antenna should immediately go up. Okay, you have to think about why is this a conspiracy theory. So let me look into it. Okay, so once you start this kind of attitude, then you are going to discover amazing things, how the world works. You need to understand what wealth concentration really means. And then most importantly, in today's world, human to human networking has really taken a beating. I am not referring to the business networking. Okay, so this business networking is only one part. The real part is actually human to human, as a full human being to another human being, right? For example, your family and friends and your business, everything together, you care about the whole set of people as a full human being, as you yourself are. Okay, so that is the basis for building a very healthy community and being healthy ourselves. An individual human being can only be healthy and happy only when his environment, his family and community is healthy and happy. Otherwise, he will be individualized. He will separate himself from everything else and he becomes very unwell. So the current faith crisis which is going on, like social distancing, wearing a mask for stopping a fake virus which doesn't exist at all, then these kind of things are systematically dismantling this human to human networking. Okay, so this is like really cutting a tree at its root. So we have to recognize this and then say no, I don't want this and I don't accept this. Okay, so you do have that sovereign power. When enough people wake up and then say no, nothing can happen. Okay, so you have, that is a tremendous power. That is the only power that all the rulers are afraid of. So exercise that. That is going to come to you only if you gain that knowledge and gain that understanding of what is really happening. Okay, and this will definitely lead you why a small self-sustaining community, many such communities coming together and living, that is the best model of this world, which actually existed before. Okay, so this is all, that is all I have for today. So here are some people that you can listen to. You can go on YouTube and listen to some of the things these people are saying. It's amazing stuff. They will give you perspectives on what true freedom means, how society can be, a true society can be, right? So Larkin Rose and Mark Pascio in India. So my Facebook friend Johan Tegra has been putting up amazing stuff, videos in Hindi and English as well. Please go ahead and listen. Okay, so that's all, and thank you very much for listening. See you in the next session.